Yeah, amen. Amen. Moms are pretty great, right? And it's not just a biological thing. I think of all of the women in my life who have served in the role of mom, not just my adoptive mom or my birth mom or friends' parents who treated me like their own child. Moms are fantastic. All the women who played a role in my life. Will you just take a moment and give thanks for not just moms, but yeah, and applause. I want to. Thank you for that. I also want to, let's go before the Lord too and just thank Him for the women in our lives and the roles that they played. Father, we are grateful for, yes, our mothers, but on this day when we celebrate mothers, we know that You have divinely designed women and uniquely gifted them, Lord, to serve a role in Your creation that I can't, that we as men can't. And we desperately need women to be who You've created them to be the moms, to be compassionate, to be kind, to be courageous, Lord, to do all the things You've divinely designed and created them to do, Lord. We are so grateful for them, and we just pray Your blessings upon every woman in this room and every woman across our campuses today, Lord. Pray that You would bless them and just continue to use them and help us to look and to see all of the greatness that is in them that is put there by You. And so thank You again for them, Lord. Use them mightily in our lives. And Father, just thanks. Thank You so much for the women and the moms in our lives. We are so, so grateful. We need them. Lord, thank You. Amen. You know, I think about that. I think of, like, the different people that have played that role. My mom, who raised me. She adopted me along with my father and raised me from the age of 3 months. My birth mom, who gave me life. And later, I was able to come back into her life and has played a role model in my life. I think of friends' parents who've been role models. My mother-in-law, who's been a phenomenal role model. My best friend from college to this day call his mother mom because she's been like a mother to me, right? It's not just a biological thing. But these women have been tremendous role models. There's things in my life that are good because of every one of them. Moms can be great role models. So can our dads. Who are the role models in your life? Who are the people that you could say right now, there's something good about me because I learned it from them. I watched them. I imitated them. Moms and dads usually come to mind pretty quickly. Maybe it was a coach. Maybe it was a teacher, professor. Maybe it was just a neighbor. Maybe it was just somebody you met along the way. Maybe it was a peer who you've tried to model your life after, right? You know, as a pastor, you meet guys and they're like, oh, are you getting mentored by Wayne Grudem or John Piper? That's just so cool because they're just so theologically awesome. If you don't know who they are, they're two of the leading theologians in the U.S. right now. Right? We look for good role models. We don't want to follow the bad ones. Interestingly enough, I went on Google and I typed in worst role models, just curious to see what Google would spit out. And it was a long list of people, and there were multiple lists that you could check. And you know, and here's the thing, like, it wasn't ripping people to shreds, but it basically said these people are bad role models because they've made bad choices, and they seem to keep making bad choices. On the list were people like Tiger Woods or Lindsay Lohan, Lil Wayne, Kim Kardashian, and the list goes on of people that they've made bad choices. They're probably not the people we're following our lives after. And I was thinking too, like, back in the day, it might have been cool to say, you know what, I had the privilege of serving on the president's staff. I learned a lot from him. But nowadays, you wouldn't probably say that about either one of our recent or past president. You wouldn't say, they're my role model in life, President Trump or President Biden. You probably wouldn't say that they're your role model in life. Role models are great. We just want to choose the right ones. We want to learn from the right role models. Well, today I want to look at the life of a role model that is very, very unlikely, an unlikely role model. I want to unpack the life of somebody who, at least initially when you read about their story or you read the first four words that talk about them, five words in the New Testament, definitely not somebody you would chalk up as a role model. If you've ever read the book of Hebrews, let me just say this first. We're going to be in Joshua 2, so grab your Bibles, open them up. Like, we don't just do this for entertainment, right? We're hoping you're going to follow what we're doing, underline, circle, take notes so you remember. We're going to be in Joshua 2, but I'm going to start in Hebrews 11 real quick because that's where our story starts. If you've ever read Hebrews 11, we call it the Heroes of the Faith chapter, right? The Hall of Faith. These are men and women who God has raised up and said, these are men and women you should try to emulate. Try to be like them. They did it right in the Old Testament. They got it right, these men and women. And you're not surprised when you start to read it. You read about Gideon or Samson or Moses or Enoch. These are people who did amazing things for God. Yeah, they made mistakes here and there, except maybe like Enoch, but they did amazing things for God. Most of their life looks pretty good. Mistake here, mistake there, but not a big deal. But then you come to verse 31. And you come to read about a woman named Rahab. And you read, by faith, right, she's being commended for her faith. By faith, Rahab, the prostitute, did not perish with those who were disobedient because she had given a friendly welcome to the spies. But you read those first 5-6 words and you think, why is she in here? She, like, first reading, she doesn't really, yeah, okay, she did something nice, but does she really belong there, right? That's how our culture tends to think. Well, she's doing something that's incredibly sinful, especially back then. This was a profession that was looked down upon. But here's the thing, she's in here. She's a hero of the faith. Yes, she's an unlikely role model, but she is one. And there's some beautiful lessons we learn from her life that I want us to learn today. And what we realize too, bigger picture, this is the key. In fact, if you read through Hebrews 11, you're going to read by faith, Samson, by faith, Gideon, by faith, David, by faith, Rahab. She's being commended for her faith, and we can learn so much from her and what she did. Yes, she gave friendly welcome to the spies. Her faith changed everything about her. And so I want to learn these lessons today. Before we dive into Joshua 2, if you're not there, get there, because we're going to start there. I want to ask one favor, too. See, this past month, Amy and I went to a marriage conference. It's called Weekend to Remember, if you've ever been to one. They're fantastic. And in all honesty, we went, we're like, yeah, you know, it'll be fun. We'll have fun. We're in a good place in our marriage. I don't think we need a lot of help right now. You know, maybe we'll learn something. Maybe we won't, you know. It'll be good, though. We'll have fun. We'll get a weekend away from the kids. And within 24 hours, I'm almost in tears repenting to my wife, confessing and asking for her forgiveness for things I hadn't even thought of, I wasn't even aware of. My point is this, I share that because how often do we maybe come to something like this, a Sunday morning, a women's conference, a men's conference, and we think, man, you know, it's going to be fun. I get to be with my friends, and we're going to see everybody, and it's Mother's Day, and we get pictures. It's going to be great, but we don't stop and think, hey, you know what? Maybe I need something. Yes, I got something out of that marriage conference. How much more might I have gotten had I gone and going, Lord, show me something. Show me something. And so I have a favor this morning. Would you right now where you're sitting just utter that prayer? So that we're not here out of routine, we're not here out of habit, we're not here because it's Mother's Day and my mom's making me go to church. But would you just utter that prayer quietly to yourself, Lord, show me something today. What do I need to learn today? It's kind of like a little tune-up. You bring your car in, you didn't know you had a problem, you realize you have a problem. And I got plenty of problems. So let's dig in. Two lessons we learn from Rahab. The first one is this, if you're taking notes, is this. God's grace covers your past. Think on that for a second. Think of what that really means. God's grace covers your past. Not just some of it, all of it. Everything that's coming to your mind right now that nobody else knows about, it's covered by God's grace. All of it. Let's take a look. Joshua chapter 2, starting in verse 1. And Joshua, the son of Nun, let me set the background, by the way, just so you know where we are, right? Israel had been set free. They had come to the promised land. Moses had sent in 12 spies, of which Joshua was one of them. The spies came back. 10 of them said, we can't go in there. We're going to get destroyed. These people are giants. 2 of them were faithful and said, no, we should go, but they didn't. And so 40 years wandering in the wilderness. And now they've come again. Joshua is the leader. They've come again to the edge of the promised land. He sends in spies. This time, not 12, but 2. Maybe he learned a lesson. Joshua, the son of Nun, sent 2 men secretly from Shittim as spies, saying, go view the land, especially Jericho. So this is where we're going to be, is in Jericho. It's important that we note this, not just because it's a geographic thing, but you need to know something about Jericho. It was debased. It was immoral. Their religion, pretty much everything about them, think of it, whatever comes to mind, it was happening there. Their religion was atrocious. Their behavior was immoral. And so we're learning, this is where the city is. And by the way, Rahab lives here. Let's continue. And they went and they came into the house of, here it is again, of a prostitute. They're with Rahab, whose name was Rahab. And they lodged there. So think about that for a second. They lodged there. They're staying with her. What does that mean? It doesn't mean they took advantage of her services. In fact, there's no biblical evidence whatsoever, historical evidence, that they actually took advantage of what she does. But what this paints a picture of is she actually has a home where this goes on. It's actually a lodge. It's believed this was more of a place where you went to drink and have a meal, rent a room, and if you wanted to, engage in the extracurricular activities. that there might well have been more women living with her, potentially. It's believed, potentially, that she actually was maybe more like a madam. So she not only was a prostitute, she was helping other women do the same thing. We're in Jericho. It's immoral. They come to the house of a prostitute. And the king, and it was told to the king of Jericho that this was happening. These spies were there. Behold, men of Israel have come here tonight to search out the land. And the king of Jericho sent to Rahab, saying, bring out the men who have come to you, who entered your house. For they have come to search out all the land. But the woman had taken the two men and hidden them. And she said, true, the men came to me. She would have been great if she stopped there. She doesn't stop. But I do not know where they were from. And when the gate was about to be closed at dark, the men went out. What? The men went out. Here it is again. I do not know where the men went. Pursue them quickly, for you will overtake them. We're seeing this picture of a woman who lives in Jericho, a place that is immoral. It's depraved, it's perverse, and she lives there. This is who she's been, is immoral, depraved, and perverse. That's who she's been. She's also a prostitute. We see now that she, big time, is a liar as well, right? Maybe not as big of a deal, but she's a liar. Put all this together, guys. But we know, why is she in this chapter? Why is she in chapter 11 of Hebrews? Because she's a hero of the faith. This is who she was. Even though by this moment in the story, she's actually a Christian. We're going to see that in a little bit. She's actually, well, I would say a believer. She's come to know the Lord by this moment. We're getting a picture of her previous life, of who she was. I want to acknowledge the lie real quick, right? Because a lot of us, I know, can get stuck on that. She lied, right? This is a righteous lie. She protected the saints. She protected the spies. I've read a lot of commentaries, and if you go home and you read them, you're going to find that scholars even argue about this. Well, it's a righteous lie. It's kind of like a military feint. It's okay. But I keep coming back to God's word. I want to say four quick things about the lie. Number one, she is nowhere commended in Scripture for lying. Nowhere. She's held up as an example of her faith and her obedience after coming to faith. That's it. Never for her lie. Ever is she commended anywhere. We already saw that in Hebrews 11. She was commended for being welcoming to the spies and helping them out, not for lying about it. Second thing I want you to remember, too, the God of the universe, the God who authored his word, the God who created you and chose you and saved you and predestined you before all time, he himself cannot lie. It's part of his nature. By the way, whose image are we created in? God's, who cannot lie. Who are we called to be like? Jesus Christ, the Son of God, who cannot lie. It says it throughout the Word of God. And this same God who created you and saved you and loves you, third thing I want you to know, Proverbs 12:22 says this, lying lips are an abomination. That's how he feels about lying. One last thing about it too, I think we need to always remember, right? John chapter 8, verse 44, Satan is the father of lies. In this moment, she's actually acting like Satan, just like we all do when we lie, by the way. When you lie, you're acting like the devil. So just, can we shelve that? That's our little cul-de-sac and put it on the shelf. The lying, not a good thing. It's still part of her fallen nature or her immaturity in knowing the Lord. People argue too, but it still came for some good. Doesn't matter. It's still a lie, right? It's still a lie. Bottom line, right? She's not really a great role model. Again, if you look at Hebrews 11, you could have read about Abel, who was commended by God for the good things that he did. It says that Enoch pleased God. She doesn't seem so pleasing to God right now. She seems kind of dirty. Noah had a reverent fear for God. Moses chose to be mistreated. Right? They seem like better role models. But this is the whole point of this first part of Joshua chapter 2. Your past doesn't matter. Right? Look what she did. She brought them up to the roof and she hid them with the stalks of flax that she had laid in order to the roof. She told the other guys they were gone, but she hid them. She was there. So the men pursued after them on the way to Jordan as far as the fords, and the gate was shut as soon as the pursuers had gone out. Your past doesn't matter to the Lord. Doesn't matter at all. Even as I say this, is anybody sitting here thinking, but John, you just don't know, my sin is too great. John, if you knew what I did, if you knew my greatest secret, not even my spouse knows, not even my kids know, nobody knows, you don't realize God can't forgive that. Did you hear the story we just read? The amount of sin in this woman's life? Let me ask you a question. Right now, if I were to say, if there were a sin that I were to mention from the stage out loud, which sin would make you cringe in your seat? Because nobody knows you did it. Maybe there isn't one. Maybe you know the grace of God. Maybe you've basked in his grace and praise God for that. I hope that's the case for most of us. But if by chance you're sitting here and right now you are starting to maybe squirm a little bit, you're like, but my parents don't know, and my kids don't know, and my spouse, nobody knows, John. That maybe we've given in to shame and fear. Let's not forget again, Rahab was depraved and perverse and immoral. She's a prostitute, a liar, an unbeliever, unfaithful, disloyal, deceitful, and I can keep going. And that was all covered by God's grace. All of it. All of it. As is yours. Whatever is making you squirm, whatever it is that nobody knows, it is covered by God's grace. Your past does not matter. David, another hero of the faith, was also a murderer. Abraham and Jacob as well, the heroes of the Jewish faith, two of the heroes of the Jewish faith, Abraham and Jacob, were liars. Thomas, one of the apostles, I love this. I go back and read the Gospels, that he's standing a few feet from the risen Christ. He's looking right at the risen Christ. You can't miss him. He's standing in front of you. And Thomas goes, I'm not going to believe unless I can stick my finger in the hole in your hands. And yet he's a hero of the faith. He's a role model. Elijah, one of the great prophets of the Old Testament, had a massive mental breakdown, emotional breakdown, still used mightily by God. The woman at the well had five husbands, and when Jesus met her, she was living with another man who wasn't her husband. Peter himself, one of the closest people to Christ during his time on earth, denied Christ publicly. All of this is covered by God's grace. All of these men and women did mighty things for the Lord. If I haven't convinced you yet, let me tell you one more story. This is a modern story, at least for those of us who are a little older. So back in the late night, I grew up in New Jersey until I was 13. And in the late 70s, I remember hearing about this on the news. In New York City, we were about 40 minutes from New York City. And in the late 70s, there was a serial killer who would sneak up on people in cars and shoot them. He became known as the Son of Sam. Those of you who are older like me probably remember hearing about that. And I remember talking to my parents, like, might he come to New Jersey? Might he come to New Jersey? And they're like, chill, right? But David Berkowitz was his real name, shot 13 people in their cars in the 1970s. He was eventually caught and arrested. Six of those people did die. Eventually caught and arrested. David Berkowitz was a murderer. He attempted to kill a bunch of other people. Why did he do it? Because he was part of a satanic cult. He worshipped Satan. You talk about being on the other team, he was on the other team from Jesus. Right? You hear this, you think, this guy does not deserve the Lord. He does not deserve grace. This is unforgivable. That's what our culture would say. Our culture would say this guy deserves the death sentence. That's what David Berkowitz thought. This is what he said. He wrote this in his journal at one point. He said, I did not think that God would ever forgive me or that he would want anything to do with me. Anybody feel like that? And if you don't, praise God, because hopefully it's because you just know his grace. But I'm just betting somebody does. What would God ever want to do with me? But this is the beauty of David's story. About 10 years after being arrested, he writes this. One night I was reading Psalm 34. I came upon the sixth verse of which it says, listen to this. This poor man cried, and the Lord heard him and saved him out of all his troubles. It was at this moment in 1987 that I began to pour out my heart to God. Everything seemed to hit me at once, the guilt of what I had done and the disgust at what I had become. Late that night in my cold cell, I got down on my knees and began to cry to Jesus Christ. Who you were does not matter. Please hear me on that. Who you were before Christ does not matter. And neither do the sins you've committed since you've come to him. God's grace covers your past, all of it. David Berkowitz sits in jail. He is denied pardon. They've tried to get it for him. He says, I don't want it. This is my ministry. This is my life. I deserve this punishment. I did something bad, but I can stay here and lead other prisoners to Christ. That's what he's been doing since 1987. God's grace covered his past. It covers Rahab's past. It covers all of our past. If you still don't believe me, because I'm just John, listen to God's word. Hebrews chapter 8, for I, this is the Lord speaking, and this is a quote of the Old Testament talking about Israel, but being quoted here because it applies to the church, I will be merciful toward their iniquities. Iniquities, big word for sin and all the bad things you've done. I'm gonna show you my mercy, which means I'm not gonna give you what you deserve, but he goes on, and I will remember their sins no more. I can't explain how this works. No scholar can. That the divine God of the universe, who knows all things at all times, chooses to no longer remember our sins. That sin you confessed 20 years ago that you still feel guilt about and you keep bringing up to the Lord's going, I don't know what you're talking about. Because he forgave it 20 years ago when you asked for his forgiveness. That guilt and that shame is not of the Lord. That belief that he's still holding this over your head is not of the Lord. Why? Because he remembers it no more. You don't believe me yet? One more, and I could keep going, but we don't have time, so this will be the last one. As far as the east is from the west, okay? So as far as things could possibly, basically infinity. Infinity to infinity is really the picture. As far as you could possibly even imagine getting, so far does he remove, love that, our transgressions, another big fancy word for sin, from us. You've confessed it, it's done, it's gone. It's so far gone, he chooses not to remember it ever again. That's the grace of God. Yes, it covers your past, all of it, every piece of it. And so this morning I would ask you, would you respond, right, like Rahab, by faith? Maybe for the first time, maybe this is the first time you've heard that. Would you respond and cry out for the grace of God and let it change you? Let it cover your past, all of it? Because I'm telling you, he wants to do that. Would you stay here this morning, talk to us when we're done, and let that happen for you for the first time? And for those of us that maybe gave our lives to Christ a long time ago, but have still been hiding, still been carrying around that guilt or shame, will you cry out to the Lord and let his grace wash over you? Because your sins are covered. I love what one author wrote. God's grace is available to anyone regardless of their reputation or prior lifestyle. Stop letting your past dictate your future. Stop letting that guilt and that shame. I've got to be better because I was so bad back then. Guys, you know, I was sitting there during worship. I was thinking back to my mom. I put her through the ringer. Like I apologize. After I came to know Christ, I apologized to her for years because I had put her through the ringer. And this is not an exaggeration, because right, sometimes pastors like to exaggerate sometimes. But I spent 3 consecutive years grounded growing up. Yeah, you can laugh. It wasn't funny then. But no, like my kids love that story. My mom's still like 3 consecutive years grounded. I got grounded, and while I was grounded, I did something I shouldn't do. I got grounded, I can't remember what for. But then I decided, you know, I was going to sneak the car out at 14. And they caught me sneaking the car out, so I got grounded even longer. And I got tired of waiting at home, so then I snuck out one night and while I was grounded, so I was not allowed to go outside, and didn't come home till 2 in the morning while they were awake with the police in the driveway waiting for me because they thought I had died. And the list goes on and on and on. The one thing I never did was get brought home by the cops, but that's only because I was faster than my friends. It's true. 3 years grounded. And, you know, yes, a bunch of that was actual sin, real sin. You know, I met a friend of mine about 4 years after college. I was a pastor. I was pastoring. I graduated. I was in my first pastoral role. A friend of mine from high school, I run into him. Nichols, what are you up to nowadays? And I knew this was going to be fun. I said, actually, I'm a pastor over at this church in Lake Zurich. And he just busted up laughing. No, seriously, like, seriously, dude, what are you doing? No, I'm not kidding. I'm a pastor, Lake Zurich. His jaw, he just froze, like, you? Seriously? Wow. Don't let your past dictate your future. God's grace covers it. It covers your past, and that leads us to our second point. God's grace transforms your future, guys. God just doesn't want to cover it. He wants to change everything about you to be who he designed you to be, who he's saved you to be. He wants to change who you are and how you live. Go back to Joshua. Right? Continue in our story. So where had she hidden the men, right? Well, before the men lay down, she came up to them on the roof, right? That's where they were, and said to the men, I know that the Lord has given you the land. I know. I know that the Lord has given you the land and that the fear of you has fallen upon us. How does she know this? I don't know. Let's keep reading. And all the inhabitants of the land melt away before you. For we have heard, we have heard, how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea before you when you came out of Egypt. And what you did to the two kings of the Amorites who were beyond the Jordan, to Sihon and Og, who you devoted to destruction. And as soon as we heard, there it is again, our hearts melted. And there was no spirit left in any man because of you. I'm going to stop there for a second. Right? She says, I know. We've heard. I know. We've heard. Well, how do you think she knows all this stuff? What did she do? An unfortunate, maybe, benefit of her profession. She met men from her city regularly who probably went out and came back and went out and came back and brought stories. And unfortunately, she might have met some Jews who maybe came to her home. She heard story after story after story. The New Testament tells us, right? We hear the gospel, and that's how we get saved. She was hearing stories of this amazing God, stories of what God had done for Israel, how he'd parted the Red Sea, how they've defeated kings they never should have defeated, but God was on their side. And her whole nation had melted away. And then we come to what we would call her profession of faith, right? We say this here at Harvest, that a true Christian is somebody who professes Christ, practices Christ, and perseveres in Christ. And this is the beginning. I think this happened in her life before this moment, but she's now saying it publicly. For the Lord your God, here it is, he is God in the heavens above and on the earth beneath. She professes her faith in Christ. She's telling them, listen, you might have just come here on a whim. You might have just come here looking for a drink or a meal or a place to sleep. But I'm on your side. I've heard the stories. I'm on your side. I believe what you believe. And by the way, right, we talk about God wants to change your future. Think about what she's doing. She's from Jericho. She lives in Jericho. She has an illegal business in Jericho that they haven't shut down because obviously she must do the right things with the right people to keep the business open. Bribery, whatever she needs to do to keep the business open, she does it. She hasn't been shut down. But now what is she doing? She's basically betraying Jericho to protect these two guys. God is already changing her because she recognizes this is of God. This is of God. This is not of me. For doing what she's doing in this moment, she could be arrested, her business could be shut down, she could be imprisoned, tortured, or even killed. She's risking her life. She's been a believer, I don't know how long, maybe days, maybe weeks. And she's risking her life for what God wants. She's being obedient to what God is laying on her heart. And here we see that she professes her faith. But there's more to her transformation, right? The beginning of her transformation, the story goes on. Now then, please swear to me by the Lord. See, again, a non-believer would never use that phrase. They don't believe in God, but she now does. Her heart has changed. She's outwardly changing. She's helping them, right? That's what she's commended for in Hebrews. Protecting the two spies. As I have dealt kindly with you, you also will deal kindly with my father's house and give me sure sign that you will save alive. This is my father and my mother, my brothers and sisters, and all who belong to them, and deliver our lives from death. Again, think about what she does. There's so much to the truth of what she does. I think that's why every time you read her name, it's Rahab the prostitute. Not to kind of talk down to her, but because it's such a beautiful picture of transformation. Put the whole she came to believe in God thing aside. Let's go back to that earlier list. Depraved, immoral, prostitute, liar. Is that your child? Are you welcoming them home for Thanksgiving meal? I'm guessing not. Are they welcome to come over Christmas morning and open gifts to you? I'm guessing not, right? We still, unfortunately, do this in our culture. We have a child or a family member, a brother or sister, an aunt, uncle, who kind of goes off the rails and their life is so immoral, we don't want them in our house. It's a pretty confident, right, decision that she's not welcome in her home at all. probably estranged from her parents. We can be pretty confident in that because we see it in our culture today. And yet here she is saying, listen, I'm the one who's been wrong this whole time. And my family matters to me. Even if they've estranged, even if they want nothing to do with me, even whatever, I still love them. I want them saved. So again, we're seeing a change of heart from Rahab. She's already different. Maybe it's weeks, maybe it's a few months that she has come to believe in God. He's covered her past. He's already transforming her future. We see these differences in her behavior already. She's already what we again call practicing her faith. She's doing it by protecting the two Jewish spies. She's doing it by caring about her family who's basically denied her existence. We have countless stories we could talk about for transformation. Go to the New Testament. Go to the Apostle Paul's story. Right, if you're not familiar with it, his name was Saul, and he was one of the religious leaders of the time, and he went around hunting down Christians and having them killed or imprisoned. Again, I read that resume, I don't think that guy deserves the grace of God, but yet God's grace covers our past. And God's grace covered Paul's past. And Paul would end up writing almost half the New Testament and becoming one of the great biblical modern New Testament saints. Because God changed him drastically. The guy who was hunted and killing Christians would become hunted himself. Beaten, tortured, stoned almost to the point of death, imprisoned multiple times, willingly, because God so changed him and transformed him. Let me ask you, how has God changed you? When did you give your life to Christ? When was that first moment when God's grace washed over your sins and Christ came into your heart? How has he changed you since then? I hope there are a lot of things coming to mind. How has he changed you in the last year or two? Right, this transformation goes on for our whole lives. It's not a moment like, oh, I prayed, I'm good, I'm changed, I'm new, I think differently. No, it's an ongoing, constant lifestyle of change. Are you less angry because of Christ in your heart? Are you patient and kind? Are you less fearful, more hopeful and courageous? Are you less stressful, less anxiety, more peace? I hope so. Are we less selfish and more generous? Are we more loving, more confident, more joyful? And I could go on and on and on with the list. But how has God changed you? Celebrate those things. I believe that Rahab came in contact with God's grace, and all she wanted to do was live for him, which is what God's grace should do in our lives. It covers my entire past. Mine may not look like hers on paper, but I still don't deserve heaven. I deserve hell. And God covered it. Jesus did all the work so that I could be saved and I could be transformed. I want that. We should celebrate all the ways that God has changed us, and it should make us long for more. We should celebrate all the ways that God's grace covers our sin, and it should make us want even more of it in our lives. Every day we should wake up and give thanks for God's saving grace and long for his transforming grace because of his saving grace and because of all the ways he's already transformed us. By the way, his change is always for the better, and it's always right. What God wants to do in you is always better and always right. Yes, sometimes it's hard. Sometimes it takes time. Was Rahab changed overnight? No. A little bit more in the story of Rahab. If you go ahead and read Joshua 6, we're not going to jump there for sake of time, but in Joshua 6, we read that the Jews marched around the wall. They blew their trumpets. The walls came down. Everybody in Jericho was destroyed and wiped out except for one woman and her entire family. They were rescued. They were saved. Now, we're also told initially when they came to be with Israel, they had to live outside the camp. Why? Well, they weren't Jews, and they were dirty because they were sinners like us. But we're also told, if you keep reading chapter 6, that Rahab eventually came to live in Israel for the rest of her life. She became clean. She became different. She continued to change. And not only this, you want a beautiful picture of God's grace. This is my favorite part of her entire story, and why she's become one of my heroes. Where are we going? Come on. Matthew chapter 1, the genealogy of Jesus Christ. And Ram, the father of Amminadab, and Amminadab, the father of Nahshon. Remember him, we're going to come back to him. Nahshon, the father of Salmon. Let me just say, it's believed that Salmon, again, Jewish tradition, Jewish history, not in the Bible, but it's believed he's one of the spies. He's one of the two spies that stayed at her house. Salmon, there he is again, the father of Boaz by Rahab. Now, I mentioned Nashon, the guy on the previous page. Nashon was Solomon's father. Nashon was a prince. Does that mean when he died, Solomon became a prince? I don't know. But she married into a princely, elite family. God's grace transformed her and made her something pretty special. Oh, by the way, keep reading. Boaz, her son, the father of Obed, by Ruth. Obed, the father of Jesse. The father of who? Who? David, the great-great-grandmother of King David and an ancestor of Jesus Christ himself. What a beautiful story of the grace of God. Are we all going to have a princess ending to our story on this side of heaven? No. In eternity? Oh, beyond what you can imagine. This life may not get that comfortable or that easy, and I'm betting it still probably wasn't easy. I'm betting for the rest of her life, some of the Jews, because we do this as people, Jewish or not, right? We look at people and we remember their past. We don't forget pasts, but God does. He chooses to. I have no doubt for the rest of her life. I have no doubt Solomon was looked at weird. You married that woman? You know what she used to do? I have no doubt that, right, Boaz was probably made fun of. Oh, your mother. Oh, that's your mother. So as much as it looked like it was a pretty ending for her, I have no doubt it continued to be hard. But she stayed in, and she practiced, she persevered, and her life was changed and continued to change. One author put it this way. Rahab, the one-time heathen harlot, married into one of the leading families of Israel and became an ancestress of our Lord. God's grace is incredible. Absolutely incredible. It doesn't just cover our past. It transforms our future. It transforms who we are and how we live. I want to go back to the beginning. One last thing. See, when it comes to this change piece, I often hear people say, well, John, that's great, but my life hasn't changed. When you asked me that question a few minutes ago, how has your life changed? Mine hasn't. That's usually for one of two reasons. I don't have time to go into all of them, but the two biggest reasons you haven't changed, one is you haven't given your life to Christ. I say that with no judgment at all. That maybe you've been going through routine your whole life, habit, you've attended church your entire life, but you've never truly surrendered your life like Rahab did to the Lord, like David Berkowitz did. And recognize that we desperately need a Savior. We are sinners, separated from the living God, who desperately need to be covered by His grace. And we need to come to Him and cry out to Him and be saved. And if you've never done that again, please don't walk out of here. We'll have people up front come talk to us. We'll help you take that step. But if you're sitting here going, again, John, I'm confident I've done that. I'm confident I'm a child of God. My life's not changing. Well, here's the secret. This is the second most likely reason it's not happening. Back to Hebrews 11. By faith, Rahab the prostitute did not perish with those who were disobedient. In her early faith, she was obedient, and she began to change. She cared for the spies. She was obedient, and she began to change to honor her parents and to care for her parents. The change comes as we are obedient. By the way, I know some of us hear that word and go, more I've got to do for the Lord. No, your perspective is off. Just like when Amy and I went to that marriage conference, my perspective was, we're great. I don't have any problems. The next day, my perspective changed. Oh, I have a problem. I need to go ask for forgiveness. When we think of what the Lord asks us to do, when we think of obedience as something I have to do, we have the wrong perspective. We get to be obedient. We've been saved by grace. We all deserve hell, but we've been saved by grace. Our past has been covered. He wants to change us, and we get to change. We get to. Yes, it's going to take time. So as a good friend of mine used to say all the time, lean into the Lord and His grace. Stop hiding behind the walls of guilt and shame. Stop thinking you're keeping a secret from the Lord about whatever it is you won't confess. He knows, so confess it and get right with Him. Let His amazing grace wash over you. And stop living according to your old life. Stop letting that pass. Stop thinking that this is, yes, I've put my faith in Christ, but this is still who I am. No, it's not. This is who you are. Everybody we've talked about this morning, right? They were living life this way, sinful, rejecting God. They came to Him that was washed over with grace, and they began living this way, 180-degree swing. But you do have to get up every morning and do that. And that can sound hard, that can sound overwhelming, but again, we get to do this. And there is no greater work because it's always right and it's always best. It's of the Lord. Because I want to change. I'm definitely not that idiot who was grounded for 3 years in high school. Well, really grounded for more than that, but 3 years straight. I'm not that idiot anymore. By God's grace, I'm something different. It's all him. Trust me. Spend a time in the weekend, you're like, you're still kind of a goofball. Yep. It's all him, but I want even more. That's what his grace should do. I want to lean in. I want to learn to be obedient where I am not. I want to go to conferences and recognize, oh, wait a minute, I'm still a sinner. I need to change. And here's the most beautiful part, and then I'll wrap it up with one story. Jesus has done all the work, by the way. He's done the hardest work for us. He's covered our sin. We can't do that. We can learn to be obedient with the Spirit in us, but we can't ever cover our sin. We all needed the cross. He did that work for us. That's the heavy lifting. Ours isn't heavy. It might feel like it, but again, we have his Spirit living in us to change us by his grace. My hope and prayer is that you would respond this morning like Rahab in faith. Lean in and let his grace wash over you. Close with this story. I don't know if you know John Newton's story, if you know who John Newton is. It's okay if you don't. But John Newton, if you don't know his story, is the one who gave us the song Amazing Grace. It's a little over 200 years old. We sing it, most churches sing it frequently. Even if you're not in a church, people often know the song Amazing Grace. Well, I don't know if you know John Newton's story. John Newton grew up with a mother who was teaching him all about Jesus. He was learning all the right things, going to Sunday school, learning all the right things. And then he ended up with his father about age 11, and his father worked on a slave ship. And John Newton would grow up for the rest of his life, not the rest, his formative years working on a slave ship. And this is what is said about John Newton working on a slave ship. Sailors were not noted for the refinement of their manners, right? Sailors were known for being pretty immoral back then already. But Newton had a reputation for profanity, coarseness, debauchery, which even shocked all the rest of the sailors. God doesn't deserve grace. Neither do I, right? But in 1748, he would come to know Christ. He would want off that ship in the worst way. God would eventually grant that, but it would be a while. He'd still have to work on that ship for quite a while, disgusted by what he was doing. God was changing his heart and changing his heart and changing his heart. God's grace had covered his past. He was no longer that guy. God was changing his heart. He would eventually get off that ship. And I think it's somewhere in the 1764, he would actually become a pastor. And in 1779, he would write Amazing Grace. And he would serve as a pastor for 43 years. And I love the line, Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Do you ever stop when you're singing that and realize that is each and every one of us? Sorry to ruin your Mother's Day, but we're all a bunch of wretches. We are. But we're saved by the most amazing grace. It covers all our past, and it transforms our future. Anybody want more grace? Let's get after the Lord's grace together. Would you pray with me? Father, I know how much I needed this week. And so personally, I want to say thank you. I needed to be reminded of how much I need your grace and even how much your grace has done in me, Lord. So I also say this too on behalf of our church family. We thank you for your grace. Your grace that saves us. Your grace that covers all of our sin. That's even hard for us to fathom how that happens. Because we seem to not be able to forget what we've done, but you somehow cover it and remove it from us and choose to remember it no more. Thank you, Father. Help us to learn to rest in that. Help us to accept that truth and no longer live in guilt and shame. In fact, I pray you would free any of us that are stuck in guilt and shame to give us the freedom from it. Give us the courage to walk away from it. Destroy it in our lives so that we can walk in your grace. Help us to walk in it. Help us to be transformed by it. Help us to know it like never before. Would you overwhelm us with your grace, so much so that we would be compelled to say, Lord, here is my life. Do with it as you wish. Overwhelm us with your grace. And I pray specifically too for anyone that maybe is here. Maybe it's the first time in the doors. Maybe they've gone through the motions their entire lives, but they've never surrendered to your grace. Would you overwhelm them with your grace this morning? Overwhelm them with your grace that they would walk out of here a child of God, whose past is covered and whose future is going to change. God, we thank you and we praise you for all of this. Your grace truly is amazing. Amen.